Hello guys, today we are going to discuss a small topic from neuroanatomy. They are tracts. So let's start with tracts. We will start with the descending tracts. First of all, tracts are of two types. We have ascending tracts and descending tracts. Ascending or sensory, descending or motor. See, this is a small structure of brain and spinal cord. We all know right part of the brain will control our left part of the body, and left part of brain will control right part of the body. This is because there is a decussation occur. Decussation means crossing over. Okay. We have motor cortex in cerebral cortex. It is known as postcentral gyrus. This postcentral gyrus controls the motor function. From there, the tracts will carry the messages. We have two types of tracts, pyramidal and extrapyramidal tracts. Okay. In this video, we are mainly focusing on descending or motor tracts. Motor tracts, they follow two pathways, that is pyramidal system and extrapyramidal system. So let's move on descending pathway. As I told you, descending or motor they are again divided into pyramidal and extrapyramidal. First of all, we need to know what is the difference between pyramidal and extrapyramidal. The tract which pass through the pyramidal system in medulla oblongata, some pyramidal cells in medulla oblongata, the tracts which pass through that, they all are known as pyramidal tracts. In the extrapyramidal tracts, all other tracts which doesn't pass through the pyramidal medulla oblongata, pyramidal system of medulla oblongata, they are known as extrapyramidal system. They mainly pass through the basal ganglia. Okay. Again, pyramidal system again divided into corticospinal tract and corticobulbar tract. Or it is known as corticonuclear tract. From the word corticospinal, from the cortex to the spinal cord, directly to the spinal cord, and corticobulbar or corticonuclear, from cortex to different nuclei. We know we have 12 pairs of cranial nerves. They are situated in the midbrain, the brainstem. Okay, midbrain pons medulla. They have nuclei there. So the tracts coming from cortex directly to the nuclei, and from nuclei, this motor nuclear nerves take the messages to the motor organs. So they are known as corticobulbar tract or corticonuclear tract. Okay, then corticospinal tract is again divided into lateral corticospinal tract and anterior corticospinal tract. This lateral corticospinal tract, these are the tract which undergo decussation, or they are the tracts which undergo crossing over. Okay, 80% include this 80%, they will cross over or decussate, and this decussation takes place just below the medulla oblongata. Remember, decussation takes place just below medulla oblongata. then this anterior corticospinal tract, they are only 20%. Okay, they are non-crossing, they are non-decussating. But they will cross not at medulla oblongata, but they will cross at spinal cord, at the place of synapse. When they are getting synapsed with the spinal cord, they will cross over. But the main decussation in medulla, below medulla oblongata, is only for lateral corticospinal tract. Okay. So let's see a brief scheme how it works. I will draw a short scheme for you. Let's take, this is the cerebral cortex or motor cortex, okay? This is the cerebral cortex. From cerebral cortex through internal capsule, there is a structure called through internal capsule, the tract passed down. Here we have structure known as corona radiata. Structure will be like this. So, from internal capsule, they are connecting to the cortex. They are known as corona radiata. From internal capsule, it comes to the midbrain. Midbrain, then pons, then medulla oblongata. Then we have white matter of spinal cord. From white matter, it moves to anterior horn cell. And through ventral ramming, see, there are structures in spinal cord. The motor function, it will goes to the motor organs and motor function is carried out. This is a simple structure of pyramidal system. Here we have motor cortex, that is post central gyrus area. Okay, normally pyramidal system follow this pathway from cortex through coronary internal capsule, midbrain, pons, medulla oblongata. There is three structures. Together they are known as what we call brainstem. Okay. These are the pathway of corticospinal tract. And I told you earlier there is another pathway known as corticobulbar tract from cortex to nuclei. I told you there are a lot of nuclei situated in brainstem, that is, we have cranial nerves. So what happened is that instead of going to midbrain, this path will reach in brainstem. So it follows corticobulbar tract. So from brainstem, it synapses with motor nuclei. Motor nuclei of cranial nerve. And the motor cranial will take the messages to the motor organs. This is a pathway followed by corticobulbar or corticonuclear tract. So see the difference. This is a corticospinal tract directly to the spinal cord. But here, corticobulbar from cortex to the brainstem. We have a lot of cranial nerve nuclei here. So it will come to brainstem and it will synapse with the motor nuclei of cranial nerve. And it will form, it will transmit the message to the cranial nerve, and cranial nerve will directly go to the motor organs. So it will facilitate the function there. And here also synapse taking place here. I told you earlier, below medulla oblongata, decussation take place. That's why left part of our brain will control right part of our body, and right part will control left part of our body. And there are two important terms. It is known as upper motor tract and lower motor neuron. It is exactly correct to say upper motor tract, and it will come as neuron when it is lower motor. So upper motor, UML, UMT and LMN. Upper motor tract and lower motor neuron. Okay. So when it is called upper motor tract, how we can differentiate it? Just remember, before synapse, the tract or pathway, it is known as upper motor tract, that is before synapse. And lower motor neuron is after synapse. This is clinically very important. You will have a lot of questions. I will give you an example. You know the main disease in India, the poliomyelitis. Poliomyelitis is mainly affecting anterior horn cell. It is clinically proved. It is affecting anterior horn cell. So what type of lesion is that? Which pathway is affected? Definitely it will be lower motor neuron, because it is after synapse. So we will answer it is lower motor neuron lesion in poliomyelitis. Okay. This is brief about the pyramidal system, and I will explain you briefly about extrapyramidal, and we'll go deep to other structures in next videos. Okay. Now I will explain you shortly about extrapyramidal system. Now we learned pyramidal system, the two type corticospinal tracts, then corticobulbar tracts, and how they move, and what is the difference between upper motor tract and lower motor neuron. Okay, and the decussation you understood. Now let's see what is mean by extrapyramidal tract. I told you earlier, extrapyramidal tract, the tract which doesn't pass through the pyramidal system in medulla oblongata. So they are extrapyramidal tract. You all are familiar with Parkinson's disease, right? In Parkinson's disease, the structure mainly affecting is basal ganglia, right? This tract passes through basal ganglia. So in Parkinson's disease, the tract affected is extrapyramidal tract. Extrapyramidal tract mainly comes from the reticular formation, the vestibular nuclei, olivar nuclei, tectospinal nuclei. To remember the extrapyramidal tract, we have a short Just remember VORT, V-O-R-T, okay, Bohr square T, Bohr T. So first one is the main extrapyramidal tract is vestibulospinal tract, from vestibular nuclei to spinal cord. Second one is olivar nuclei to spinal cord, olivospinal tract. And we have two, rubrospinal tract, from rubro, the red nuclei in midbrain. And we have reticulospinal tract. And last one, T, that is tectospinal tract. So remember, VORT. Extrapyramidal system or extrapyramidal tract, they are of VORT. V for vestibulospinal tract, O olivospinal, R square rubrospinal and reticulospinal, T for tectospinal tract. So let's see briefly the functions. Vestibulospinal tract, what is the main function? They activates extensor muscles. Okay, extensor. And inhibits flexor muscles. Just to remember, you see VE, that is extension. Just to remember, vestibulospinal tract, they helps in extension, activate extensor muscles and inhibit flexor muscles. The function of rubrospinal tract, just opposite, activates flexor muscle and inhibits extensor muscle. There, rubro means red nuclei in the midbrain, and reticulospinal tract, they facilitates they inhibits and facilitates voluntary movements. And tactospinal tract, they helps in maintaining posture reflex related to vision. They originate from superior colliculi, that is in midbrain. We'll discuss these steps in next videos. So tactospinal tract helps in vision, and it is mainly developed in animals, lower animals. Mainly developed in lower animals. Olive of spinal tract, the function is unknown. This unknown function. Till now, the function is unknown. Okay. So these are the main function of extrapyramidal tract. And if you ask what is the function of corticospinal tract, that is part of pyramidal system, that helps in maintaining extension and flexion of lower limbs. The distal part of lower limbs, as I discussed earlier, I forgot to mention the function. So I think you are clear about pyramidal and extrapyramidal system briefly. Now we will move to upper motor tract lesion and lower motor neuron lesion and their difference.